John Cola with GrownYourGreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for him here in Missouri, at Mansfield, Missouri, at the Baker Creek Heirloom Seed Store on location. And this is where they're having the, in April, in spring, they have the Tulip Festival. And you guys can see some beautiful tulips behind me. But the reason for this episode, and I'll have other videos at the Tulip Festival, is because I also gave a presentation here at the Tulip Festival, new and different than anything I've done before. And that's the purpose of this episode, to share with you guys my presentation that may not have the best camera work, but you guys are going to get all the information that you would have got if you came to the Tulip Festival. I encourage you guys to show up to the Tulip Festival and the Spring Festivals here at Baker Creek. They're always amazing. So many cool people to meet and all kinds of different plant starts. And of course, a shop full of seeds, things to see, greenhouse tours that go on. It's completely amazing. They usually have it in, I guess, April. And also, don't forget about the Heirloom Expo. Mark your calendars. It's coming up. It's going to be in Southern California this year. I think it's like September of this year. In any case, let's go ahead and get into my talk. It's talking about how gardeners can improve their health by doing just three simple things.
I want to introduce our friend John Kohler of Growing Your Greens. You are no doubt acquainted with his amazing work as an educator and champion of natural food and gardening. So please welcome John Kohler.
Hello. Oh, mic's loud, and I'm loud. How many of you guys already watched me on YouTube? So good, maybe like a little bit more than half. So a lot of you guys may not be acquainted with me. So I have a YouTube channel called Growing Your Greens, and I've been actually teaching gardening online, I don't know, for like 15 years at least. On my many YouTube videos, I have over like a million views on some of the videos, and I try to really go deep. Unlike a lot of people doing YouTube for, you know, their motivation is getting views and making money off YouTube, my goals are a little bit different. My goals are actually to educate people and share with people what I've learned, and actually that's what I hope to accomplish in this presentation today. That, you know, will be on the monitors, but I'm going to try to, you know, go over everything in voice, so you don't have to like necessarily see the screen. But I want to start with my story, because that's like really important. I guess you could flip a slide. My story is basically started in how I got into gardening is actually not just because, oh, my grandfather was a gardener and a farmer. Well, he wasn't. His next door neighbor was, which I remember as a kid going down to Mr. Blakely's and picking fresh strawberries and pulling radishes and carrots out of the ground and eating them as a kid. And I'm like, whoa, this is kind of neat. But then meanwhile, my parents, we lived in right outside San Francisco, California, and we just go to the grocery store. My parents would never go to a farmer's market, even though they were happening back then. In the day, although they were members of a local co-op, and we've got, you know, naturally grown organic food even back when I was growing up. But I didn't get into any of that, into gardening or anything because of that. I got into it because of my health, actually. So that's my primary reason, which is maybe not super common, but maybe getting more common these days as people's failing health because the, you know, standard American diet and food system has failed them, so then they want to, you know, eat the best foods. And actually that's how I got into it. How it started was, you know, right after college, I almost lost my life due to spinal meningitis, which the doctors said was caused by complement immune deficiency. And the doctors had no cure for me. They couldn't say, okay, John, here's this drug, we'll get you out of here. And they didn't have a treatment. So it's like, I'm only here, I can say through the higher powers, grace of God, whoever, whatever you believe or in, you know, today is actually Easter. And so I was glad, but then when I got out of the hospital, I asked the doctor a very important question, and one of the things I learned in life is to always ask a better question, and you're going to get better answers. And I like questioned a lot of things ever since I was a child, so I asked him, like, why did I get hospitalized in the first place? What, you know, he's like, well, you have complement immune deficiency. I'm like, how could I prevent this from happening in the future? Because I thought, as a young guy in my 20s, like, man, you're supposed to only be in the hospital and they're supposed to tell you you're not going to make it out alive and, you know, whatever, from some disease when you're old, when you're real old, you know. I was thinking, like, real old's like 60 back then, and now I'm thinking a little bit different. I'm like, yeah, real old's like 100.
So, I'm gonna get by with that, man.
But maybe even real old's 120, depends who you ask, I guess, because some of the longest lived people on the earth are around 120 or something. But, And it's like, how can I prevent this? And he's like, well, we got this shot for you, you know, an immunization, vaccination, whatever they want to call it. And at that, even at that point, when I was so young, I was like, you know, this is not really the direction I want to go, because it really doesn't protect you, you know, against other strains or different things, because he's like, it only protects you against a few of these different, you know, bacteria that, you know, the meningitis that you got. So then I'm like, how do I protect myself? And this is the question I left the hospital with. And I didn't answer it for many years, actually. I can't say, oh, I instantly knew. I got a download in my ear from spirits that told me to drink celery juice or whatever it is. Like, I didn't know. So, I mean, one step led to another. And, I mean, well, shorten the story because I don't know. I can tell the story the whole half hour or whatever. But I have a lot of information I want to share. So, the long story short is that I got into juicing because it could build my immune system, and eating more nutrient-dense plant foods that I have on the slide. And I started eating a raw, nutrient-dense fruit and vegetable diet, which are some of the healthiest foods on the planet in their minimally processed form. And then I've always been on this constant and never-ending improvement journey. I call it CANI, constant and never-ending improvement. And I've been researching personally and experimenting on how to eat for maximum health and extend longevity. Which, you know, hey, it's great if you're gardeners and you want to, you know, get seed diversity and grow heirlooms, but this is my specific focus, and that's where I really want to benefit you guys that showed up to my talk today, because nobody else has my exact experience. Almost a lot of their life got into gardening to grow the most nutritious food and then process it in the best ways possible, and then actually even pick seeds and grow things to, you know, benefit people's health and life. So, you can click the slide. So, there's three main principles or things that I want you guys to think about and implement on growing your own food. And these are the three most important ways, I believe, to increase your health by growing food. Is number one is choosing specific crops for their health benefits, right? And previously, before maybe like 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I would just think, oh, there's a lot of different vitamins, antioxidants, and phytochemicals in foods, which are great, and I want to eat those. So we'll eat the rainbow. We all heard that. Well, hopefully you guys are all eating the rainbow. But more recently, I've done microbiome testing on my gut microbiome, which, you know, if you're into organic gardening, you know the soil microbiome and adding compost teas to get the bacteria in there, and soil inoculants are so important. But now I know what's in my gut microbiome, and based on my gut microbiome, I can now create greater diversity of gut microbes based on the food I'm eating, which is like all new science, and most people, I mean, this is the stuff that I like live in a research studies like every day almost, which is insane. So you want to choose, instead of just, oh, I'm just gonna go ahead and get romaine lettuce, right? You can get like Lola Rosa lettuce or outrageous lettuce, which is two lettuces I grew that are super high in anthocyanins, which are red, and these anthocyanins now feed our microbiome and also give us anti-aging, anti-disease properties that are so good for us. So, you know, by simply choosing the correct seeds or different seeds, you know, instead of growing the romaine that you know and love as a kid, switching it out to red romaine, right, or growing some different crops. So that's number one, choosing specific crops for the health benefits. We'll talk about that a little bit more in detail. And then I want you guys to use growing practices, so beyond organic gardening, growing practices, to grow more nutritious crops. And surely there's people at this conference that know more than me to grow more nutritious crops, but I'm just gonna give you my approach, which is basically a shotgun approach. So I put out really good nutrients in the soil to really create the microbial and trace mineral action in the soil to grow more nutritious crops. And then finally, the other part that I'm really focused on in my life, and I don't know, I'm probably like the world's expert in this topic, in nutrient extraction through different kitchen devices such as juicers and vacuum blending. I don't know anybody else that goes in as deep as like how you process the food after you pick it, after you harvest it, to get the most nutrients, enzymes, vitamins, minerals, and phytochemicals into you. And so I'll talk a little bit about that, because that's also something that I really, really know a lot about, because I mean, I've been living that for 28 years now. So now I want to talk about choosing their crops for the most benefit. So is there just one crop that's the most beneficial? Like, people tend to be very reductionist. Like, I just want to know the best one food to eat, John, for the rest of my life so I can be super healthy. And if you ask a carnivore, he's going to say, eat meat, because meat's the best thing in the whole world to eat the rest of your life. And, you know, like as I'm getting more mature in my age, I've been seeing and learning that things are much more nuanced than this all or nothing approach. Like eat all health food and no junk food. Well, I probably agree with that one. But this all or nothing approach, like I'm all red or I'm all blue or I'm all purple or whatever, right? There's gotta be like some like in-betweens, right? I think people are too divided, whatever it is. So I don't think there's one crop that's the most beneficial. I think we should have a nice spread of different crops. But then how do you know the best vegetables to grow? Well, I'm gonna be covering that based on my personal opinion and then what I've learned through some of the science and my personal microbiome testing. And then I mentioned nuance, and nuance is so important. There's nothing's ever always black and white, there's always shades of gray. So here's the thing, there's many different components of vegetables, right? And these are just common components, and some people focus more or less on some or others of them. So the first component is carbohydrates. So some people base their diet on a carbohydrate-rich diet, like 80-10-10, for example. And vegetables contain various types of carbohydrates, such as fiber, starch, and sugar, which provide energy and contribute to digestive health. And the most important one for me is the fiber, which we'll talk about a little bit more. And then a lot of American diets are just based around carbohydrates. So like just, you know, steak and potatoes, a lot of carbohydrates, and you got your fat and your protein in there. Also in vegetables are the vitamins, such as vitamin A, C, vitamin K, various B vitamins. And these vitamins are essential for a healthy immune system, vision, you know, beta carotene, vitamin A for our eyes, and immune function. And you know, these are all important components, but I'm gonna tell you guys the most important ones for me these days. Of course, minerals are also super important. There's all kinds of chemical reactions that happen in our bodies due to the minerals in the foods. You have calcium, iron, magnesium, potassium, also more importantly, trace minerals. There's also phytonutrients, so these are very important and interesting to me. These are the components of the foods that I believe are some of the most important, actually, that most, especially Americans, are not getting in because they're eating, you know, all these white sugar, white flours, and white processed foods that don't have all these plant phytonutrients, things like, you know, isothiocyanates, you know, lycopene, anthocyanins, there's different kinds of polyphenols. There's all these new words I learn every day when I'm like researching okra and this, you know, a new word for, you know, apigenin and celery and all these crazy, you know, you need to know all those. What you need to know is that these are very powerful components of the food that I believe have disease and have been shown to have disease protection, you know, protect us from disease and anti-aging. And then of course, fruits and vegetables are also high in water content, and we should be eating, in my opinion, foods that are high in water content, otherwise they will dehydrate us. We are 70%, 72% water, something like that, and you know, the foods hydrate us as we eat them, and if you're eating processed foods, things that are fried, for example, like those will dehydrate your dehydrated foods. All right, so if you're growing foods for each of these food components, you know, I've given some examples. So if you're going to focus on growing for carbohydrates, you want to focus, in my opinion, on the prebiotic fibers. Those are the carbohydrates that are most important, including things like inulin, fructooleosaccharides. They have galactooleosaccharides. And actually, the reason why I say this is because when I did my microbiome test, it showed me that I needed to eat more of these foods, and some people, you know, don't eat a lot of these foods that actually feed our gut microbes that then make short-chain fatty acids and do a lot of other things for us to make us healthy. And so foods with inulin and FOS would include things like Jerusalem artichokes, sunchokes, people also call them fartichokes, and that's because they're feeding your microbes that create the gas that then make you fart. And that's a good thing! People probably still won't agree with me. Farting bad jokes! All right, so... Also things like, of course, regular standard artichokes also have the inulin, FOS in there. Chicory roots, also how many people eat chicory root? Or dig up their dandelions and eat the roots? Or juice them? I mean, those are so good. They're really rich in a lot of other chemicals too, but also the special prebiotic fibers. And also things, of course, like garlic and onions also have a percentage of these properties. But, you know, people aren't known for eating lots of garlic and onions. They maybe eat one or a little bit to flavor as a side. Of course, if you want to grow for vitamins, things like bell peppers, one of the highest plants for vitamin C, A, folate. Sweet potatoes, good for A, C, and B6. Broccoli, good for C, K, and folate. Basically, for vitamins, I don't try to grow for vitamins because every food basically has vitamins in it. And for me, I try to eat a lot of different kinds of foods to get all my vitamins. Of course, when I think minerals, I think leafy greens, and especially the stems of leafy greens or stem vegetables such as celery will concentrate the trace minerals in there. And then for phytonutrients, this is the area that I'm really interested in. You know, for phytonutrients, we really want to grow those rich, colorful, pigmented vegetables. Purple vegetables are my favorite. They're rich in anthocyanins. Tomatoes, of course, are rich in lycopene. If you want to grow for a water content, so like I like to juice. So instead of just drinking water from the ground, you know, that's been filtered by aquifers or, you know, even worse, water in bottles that have been filtered by, you know, man or something, I like to drink water that's been filtered by the plants. So I grow cucumbers and I take the cucumbers and then now I juice the cucumbers and I get all the water from the cucumbers. But more importantly, it's structured water. I also get the phytonutrients, the vitamins, and the minerals and some of the soluble fiber from the juices into me when I drink the cucumber juice, and the cucumber plant has filtered my water. So, you know, and most people don't drink enough, you know, I think fresh, especially vegetable juices. Fruit juices are easy, people drink orange juice all the time, but I think really vegetables really concentrate these phytonutrients that now you can extract into a juice. So I'm sure you guys have all had this problem like I've had. How many times have you walked into a seed store? I mean, we're here at Baker Creek, so you can walk in their Baker Creek seed store, which is a picture right there, and you're like, oh my God, there's like 1,000 pack of seeds. Which one do I buy?
All of them.
Yeah, that's it. That's the answer. Buy all of them. That's what Jared wants you to say. Did you get planted by him? But yeah, you just like see everything and you're like, I want to buy everything. But then maybe you go to all your staples. Like, I always like to eat romaine lettuce and, you know, early girl tomatoes or whatever. And you just buy those same ones. I really want to encourage you guys to maybe use a little bit of my suggestions to pick your seeds out. So I want you guys to choose a variety of fruits and vegetables. Don't just get the same ones you always buy year in and year out, right? Try to get, you know, some carrots, some beans, some potatoes, some, you know, leafy greens and different kinds of leafy greens, some eggplants, you know, some peppers, some spilanthes, every different kind of flower, edible flowers. And then I want you guys to choose varieties you don't normally eat because those are the nutrients that you need and your microbiome needs the most. I mean, I've been living on fruits and vegetables for like 25 years straight. And when I did my microbiome test, it showed me that I didn't have the microbes to digest like things like resistant starch because I hadn't been cooking my potatoes and hadn't been eating potatoes for like 25 years. And I'm like, whoa, I should have been eating some resistant starch foods all these years so I could have a better balanced microbiome for more diversity, because the diversity of your good and commensal bacteria have been shown to, you know, have a longer life and you can be healthier and be more disease preventative. I'm like, oh my gosh, I need to start doing this now. So that's what I'm telling you guys. So yeah, so choose ones you don't normally eat because those are the ones that you and your microbiome needs. And I want you also, of course, to choose deeply covered, deeply colored crops. So, you know, I want Jared to sell out of those purple, you know, or black carrots in his seed shop today, because all you guys I know are going to go there and buy them because they're some of my favorite. And then don't forget several types of green, leafy greens or leafy red vegetables to eat as well. Leafy greens are some of the most nutritious powerhouses, and people just, they'll eat their chicken and their steak or their potatoes, but they forget to eat their salad. If they have a salad, they have a light green salad from like iceberg lettuce here in America. I really want you guys to get those deep leafy greens, those dinosaur kale, the blue kales, the red kales. So these are some of the most important considerations for when you select your foods, in my personal opinion. So we want to eat foods that will feed our microbiome. And yeah, I encourage you guys to do a microbiome test. It's actually at the bottom of the screen. It's hombrelab.com. And the coupon code I found was romance for $10 off. And you can actually see what's in your microbiome. And then once you get your microbiome test, you could actually then, they'll recommend foods that you should eat to basically have a better balanced microbiome to feed bacteria that you didn't. So that's the best way to do it. Of course, if you don't want to do a test because they're around $100, you could just include more of the foods you don't normally eat, which in general should be pretty good. Anyways, we want to eat foods and grow foods that will feed our microbiome, the bacteria inside us that digest the foods that we don't. So through our digestive system first, you know, our bodies will extract the nutrients out of it, and then it goes to the second area where then now the microbes will basically digest our food some more, and then basically make short-chain fatty acids and other metabolites that they basically poop out that then will feed us. And how many of you guys thought you'd hear about poop today from a garden talk? All right, so I will take questions at the end. So yeah, so we want to have things like fiber, grow things rich in soluble fiber, inulin, FOS, and GOS, and resistant starches, which are considered a functional fiber. So it's like, the sweet potatoes and potatoes. And we also want to grow foods that are rich in phytonutrients if your health is important, because they've been shown in studies that have proven health protective effects to feed us and our microbiome, such as polyphenols and anthocyanins. So here's some of my favorite vegetables. They're up on the screen, but I'll list them out for those of you guys. These are some of my favorite because they're like purple. And if you guys watch me on YouTube, you'll see I really love my purple vegetables. I have whole episodes, like an hour long, where I'd say why every gardener should grow purple vegetables. And so here's a pusa, acida, black carrots. Italian, something Neroso, dandelions or red dandelions, black cherry tomatoes, scarlet kale, Brunswick red onions, little finger eggplants. I really love the little finger eggplants because they're like single serving size for me, because when I get a big eggplant, I don't know what to do with it all. Okay, so that'll end the part where I talk about the best things to grow for our microbiome and for us and the nutrients, but now I want to talk about the best growing practices. So, I'm not a soil scientist. I didn't go to school for none of this stuff. I have a marketing degree, actually, is what I went to school for. But I have really looked into and visited a lot of farms and places that grow things regeneratively and nutrient dense to like really get the most out of your plants. And so I want to encourage you and everybody here to use organic, beyond organic growing practices. How many people already grow organic here? And how many people are still using like Miracle-Gro and other conventional fertilizers just because it's easy? A couple people. So, for me, while you could just use conventional fertilizers and growing your own food at home with conventional fertilizers, those are still way better than going to the store and buying conventional food from the store. I encourage people to use organic growing methods. Unfortunately, most commercial farms and most people growing conventionally only focus on three main minerals, NPK. Some farms may get up to 15 to 16 minerals, as determined by science, that plants need. And then even organic farmers may not have the best fertility practices because the organic farming and organic label tells the farmers what they can't do, but it doesn't tell them what they should be doing to grow high quality food. So I still prefer my homegrown food even over organic food. And of course the best thing to do is get to know your farmer, and even better than that is to become your own farmer. So my goal, even though I live in a standard American tract home currently in Las Vegas, Nevada, this time of year I'm kind of missing my garden because every day I go out and pick greens for salads and I'll put them in the Instant Pot. And my favorite part of the greens that I'm harvesting right now are not even the leaves, right? I love the bolting tops. So like the bolting tops of my Mizuna, the bolting tops of my bok choy, I'll go down to the bolting top and I'll bend the stem, and the stem bends easy. I'm like, oh, that's tender. I keep going down until it's like, oh, it's pretty firm right there. I'm going to go up a little bit, then break it. Because if I get the one that doesn't break easily, then when I cook it, it's still too hard to chew on. So I just get all the tender tips and I just basically chop those up, add some beans, some rice, some potatoes, and then put them in the Instant Pot for like 2-3 minutes. Mushrooms, so good. And then of course, conventional produce and conventional growers may be using toxic pesticides and sprays. So the problem is in the American food system, and how many people still buy stuff at the grocery store? I do. I mean, people are just only growing, everything they eat is growing off their land. Nobody, yeah. So, it's all right, that's all right. My goal is to one day grow 99% of what I eat on my land. And it's probably because I want to eat other things that I can't grow in my land, in my climate zone. I'm probably going to buy other things. But the problem is there's declining nutrients in food that has been shown by the U.S. Department of Agriculture that since they've been compiling data on nutritional content of food since the 1800s. And so this is like a graph of the declining mineral content in the foods, and this only goes up to 1997. I'm sure it's just either leveling off or even still going down a little bit. And then, of course, you know, if you're still buying conventional foods, which I do on occasion when I can't find something organic and it's on the Clean 15 list, of course, because I'm not perfect and I'm not going to say I am, you know, just know that you're going to have less minerals and less nutrients in the food. And this chart is, I believe, from the Rutgers University showing the less amount of minerals in the foods, and minerals also very important for our health. And so there's been studies that correlate as the minerals go down in the food, diseases go up. You know, so that's one reason why I think disease rates have gone up, because minerals decline, but also the processed food has increased, and you know, a lot of other things, and people's microbiomes have diminished. There's so many things, but yeah, minerals are a big part of it, and this is something that they've been tracking. So I don't want you guys to grow inferior quality food, and in my opinion, standard organic practices are not enough. Compost and manure are not the only fertilizer you guys should be using. Especially, I was just talking to somebody here who's telling me like there's all the, you know, hay and different manures are getting got grazed on, and like pesticides that go through the, you know, cow's digestive system, and then you put the hay on your field, you put it, add the manure, and you could kill your vegetables because of it. It's just getting insane, all the chemicals out there. So I want you guys to improve your growing practices, and I want you guys to focus on adding trace minerals to your soil, including things like rock dust, sea minerals, and soil humates. How many people here already do these things, or at least a couple of these things? So a few hands, so you guys are advanced. So like, you don't need to do these things to grow plants, but if you do these things to grow plants, your plants are going to be healthier, they're going to contain more trace minerals, then you get them into you, it's going to make your plants tastier and taste better, because all these flavor notes, like, everybody loves potato chips because they got the salt on them, but ever try eating potato chips that are fried without the salt? They don't taste as good. So these, we have mineral receptors on our tongues that'll make the food taste better. When you even get like 1 teaspoon of like sea salt, this is the easy way to do it. Just go to your health food store, get some sea salt, 1 teaspoon, add it to a gallon of water, right? And then just take that and spray it on your plants like once a month, on the top of leaves, under leaves, a little bit on the soil. But just a very, because this is very high in sodium, so we, but it has a lot of trace minerals because it's the ocean minerals from the sea. I mean, they have like special ocean minerals you can get with the sodium removed that then you can spray on your crops in higher quantities. But even just doing a simple practice like that can increase the trace mineral content of your food. And I've been adding rock dust since my friend Don Weaver, who wrote a book on remineralization, talked to me about it like 20 years ago at this point. And it was amazing when he started giving me some food, because I was eating like a, you know, organic diet and eating, you know, stuff from the farmer's market. And I visited Don one time and he's like, here, John, try this zucchini. And I'm like, wow, Don, your zucchini tastes better than anything I've ever tasted before. Why is that? And he's like, it's the rock dust, John. And I have videos on my YouTube channel talking about rock dust. It's basically just ground up granite or basalt rocks into a powder, you know. And then you just add it to your ground. I mean, you get, some rock quarries will sell this rock dust waste product so that you can start doing this easily. I also want you guys to focus on the microbiome of your soil. I'm now focusing on my microbiome, but I've been focusing on the microbiome of my soil for many years. I mean, the easiest way to do that is brew some worm compost tea. I mean, there's a guy here that's actually selling worm casting as a little bubbler going, so you can brew some worm compost tea. And that will introduce a lot of different microbes, including the fungi, into your soil. That is really the soil engine that breaks down the organic matter that then gives nutrients to your plants. And I'm no expert on this microbiome of soil stuff, but I know to add a lot of different microbiome things, and I use a lot of different powders and, you know, EM1 to add some microbes into my soil, and things just grow great. And from people that I've gotten feedback from, John, when I did the compost tea, my garden exploded, and they're just getting amazing results. So, I mean, I really think there's something to it. Besides things like compost tea, you want to work on building your fungal networks. I mean, most people use bacterial-based composts, but there's also things as fungal composts that are basically, if you take wood chips and let them break down for about 3 years, you'll get a nice fungal compost that has a lot of more fungal activity than bacteria. You could also make a leaf mold compost, so when the leaves fall in the fall, just collect them and just let them break down naturally. You'll have like a 50-50 ratio approximately of fungal to bacteria. But when you're making a heat-based compost, which is what most composts you'll buy at municipal facilities, And in the industry, you know, they're making their compost within 30 to 60 days by using, you know, using a heat base, which is basically going to kill off the fungi but keep a lot of bacteria. So I see a lot of gardens, I believe, have too much bacteria and not enough fungi. So worm castings is another way you guys could do that. Good wood chip humus-based compost. And then, of course, another thing very important for the soil is we want to add carbon back to the soil. We're extracting carbon from the soil. You know, I drove here in a rental car. I have an electric car at home. And I put carbon in the air. But in my garden, I put carbon in the soil. So I use things like biochar and wood chip compost, soil humates, to add the carbon back into the soil. So those are some of the tips on growing practices, and then now I want to talk about the best food preparation techniques, because that's an area that I'm really involved with every day, because as much as I grow my own food, I also have been preparing my own food, even when I'm not growing my own food to prepare, because I got to eat every day. So the proper food preparation should minimize nutrient loss while maximizing your health benefits and making food palatable and tasty at the same time. So I advocate for eating your foods, your fruits and vegetables raw whenever possible, as heat processing your food can lower nutrition of food and generate carcinogens depending on how you cook it. Some foods need to be heat processed to break down toxins before consumption. All right, so you have an advantage because you guys are gardening and because you're growing your own food, but also we have the best processors on the earth. So I'm never going to tell you, you guys got to buy a juicer or a vacuum blender to process your food. Hopefully all you guys have your real teeth and take care of your teeth. Just this past year, I actually had a bunch of dental work I had to get done because I have been neglecting my teeth. But our teeth are probably the best food processors on the planet. Unfortunately, most people do not chew their food enough, especially leafy greens, right? We need to break those leafy greens down and things like carrots. We need to chew those up into a mush and then swallow it to get the optimal digestion. If you take two chews and swallow these leafy greens and carrots and other vegetables, right, you're not going to digest them so well. And when you look in the toilet after you go to the bathroom, you're probably going to see, you know, little bits of leaves and things happening in there because they just went through your hole, and that's not doing you any favor. So we really want to pulverize these things as much as possible through chewing effectively. So if you are tired of chewing, don't have teeth, the best way to process food, to break the food down, to basically explode the fibers and open up the cell walls to get more nutrients, is to use a vacuum blender. Not a traditional blender, a vacuum blender. How many people have heard of vacuum blenders before? So a few guys, maybe you guys already follow me, because I'm one of the only people that even talk about this, because nobody really knows what it is, right? So you think, oh, that blender on the screen just looks like a regular blender, John. So it does. So it's a regular blender, but there's one step super critical before they blend is they basically, you put a vacuum pump on top. And if you're handy, you guys can make your own vacuum blender. You don't have to buy one. But basically what you do is you put a vacuum pump on top of the blender craft and you suck out the excess oxygen out of the blender craft before you blend. And then in an oxygen-deprived environment, you blend up your food to basically blow open all the cell walls. Because the issue is, I mean, you guys had some tornadoes here somewhere in this part of the country lately. It rips up houses and all these things and destroys and kills people. But if you look in the middle of your blender as you're blending, you got a funnel cone that's basically blowing open cell walls and destroying phytonutrients and oxygen-sensitive nutrients. At the same time, you basically are thinking you're doing a good thing, which I'm not going to say blending's bad, because, hey, surely a blended smoothie or whatever you're blending at home is definitely be better than opening up a soda or, you know, something else you buy at the store. But, you know, I'm all about maximizing your nutrition. Even with just changing out your blender, there's a little, you know, graph on the screen on how your vitamin A could, you know, double by vacuum blending. Your vitamin C will increase a little bit, but more importantly, those polyphenols and those purple colors and lycopenes and things in the food that I'm really into. Also, in this slide shows it doubles, it could up to triple actually, some of those phytonutrients in the food by vacuum blending. And, you know, there's unfortunately vacuum blending in the U.S. market has pretty much failed, so all the manufacturers stopped selling vacuum blenders, unfortunately. I just came from the trade show in March for the housewares industry, and there's like hardly nobody there selling them. There's a few companies that make them. The good news is if you already have a BlendTech or Vitamix, which are the two best-selling blenders in the country, and high-end blenders anyways, there are options for you to buy a new carafe or even just for the blend tank. You can just get a lid that basically adds a vacuum pump in there so you could automatically vacuum blend your food now for as low as like $200 as an upgrade option. And if you're interested in vacuum blending, you guys could look up my videos on that. But, you know, my friend says once you go back, you don't go back. And like, once you try vacuum blending, you won't really understand it until you try it because it doesn't have all the air mixed in. So when you blend traditionally, you can add this much ingredients. Then when you're done blending, it went up to this level. That's because you blended a lot of air. So now you're swallowing air, which then you can get gas and bloating, also lowering the nutrition, also reducing the color and also the flavor profiles, because the flavor profiles are some of those nutrients that you're now missing. In addition, because you've blended in all the air, there's air bubbles that are in that mixture that they're now going to basically pop and oxidize the nutrients more as the mixture sits. So if you could vacuum blend something and drink it the next day, and it's going to taste almost the same as the day before, whereas if you blend up like a smoothie with like bananas, coconut water, and greens, and then you don't drink it all and you let it sit for 2 hours, you come back later and drink it 2 hours later, it's like tastes gross, right? So vacuum blending is really important. You can look at my videos on that if you guys want to learn more. Of course, another thing that I'm really into is juicing, and this slide there has a picture of my favorite juicer. This is the Nama J2 juicer. This makes juicing as easy as a coffee maker. One of the big things with juicing, you've got to sit there and push produce in, and it takes all this time. With the Nama, you basically load up that hopper at the top with all your produce, and if you pack it in with fruits, you could get up to 32 ounces in one sitting. Or if you do with like vegetables, you get about 24 ounces or so. You turn it on, you walk away. So I actually just recently posted a video showing me setting up a coffee maker and that juicer, loading up with coffee and water, loading up with some fruit, turning it on and walking away, letting the juicer do the work, letting the coffee maker work. And I mean, the juicer was done faster than it took than the coffee maker to make, you know, the same whatever 4 cups of coffee. Now it was a cheap coffee maker from Walmart, but nonetheless, it just shows that juicing could be easy. And the reason why I love the juicing is because it makes some of these fibers digestible for us. I actually have a video recently where I'm juicing grass. I juice grass in the Nama J2 juicer. And it does extract the nutrients from the grass, just the green juice. Now, it's pretty hardcore, but this stuff is loaded with nutrition. And how many people in here eat grass regularly? I mean, I take a wheatgrass powder. I don't even juice this stuff normally. Increasing our vegetable consumption is probably one of the most, the vegetables are the most, and colorful vegetables and leafy green vegetables are the most nutritious foods we need to eat for health and for our life extension and for disease prevention if those things are important to you. And luckily, because I almost died when I was younger, these things are very important to me, and that's why I'm so crazy about this stuff. And maybe I'll rub off on you just that much and I'll feel good about myself today because I've helped a few of you guys eat a little bit more salads, get more greens in you from vacuum blending or juicing. But the cool thing about juicing is that it allows me to concentrate the amount of food or greens, especially in vegetables, I get into me. So I couldn't sit here and eat like 1 pound of carrots. Like that's too many carrots, man, I would get tired. But I could put a pound of carrots through the juicer and it makes 1 cup, 8 ounces of juice, and I can drink it and don't just like chug it down because it tastes nasty. Actually, carrot juice can taste quite good if you got some good carrots. But now I got all the nutrients from the carrots that my body can easily digest in an easy to assimilate form into meat, including all the beta carotene for my eyes and all the farcarinol, which are anti-cancer properties in carrots. I mean, they have a thing called the Gerson therapy where they use carrots and apples to, you know, cure people of incurable diseases, supposedly. And there's, you know, people like cured themselves from cancer off this carrot, apple, you know, Gerson therapy juice stuff. So anyways, I'm all for juicing. And if you got a juicer, use a slow juicer. Very important, much like the nutrient losses you will get from going from a traditional blender with the air in it to a vacuum blender to removing the air and then blending. You can get from a high-speed juicer that basically is running at 20,000 RPM to a slow juicer like the Nama that runs at 50 revolutions per minute. So it's not oxidizing and adding all the air into there. So it's going to preserve more of those phytonutrients for you guys. And of course, fermentation is something also super important, super critical, and I believe everybody should be doing for their health, especially having an overabundance of the different kinds of leafy green vegetables and vegetables in the summertime. I encourage you guys to do fermentation. There's a recent study that came out on comparing fermented foods to like eating more fiber in your diet for microbiome diversity. And basically, I mean, they're both good, but basically the probiotic foods, eating probiotic foods every day, you know, what was better for your microbiome to create more diversity than just the fiber alone. That being said, I encourage you guys not to buy fermented foods from the grocery store that tend to contain too much salt content, because eating too much salt in fermented foods could be bad for your microbiome. So you want to do it yourself with very little salt as possible. And the way I recommend to do that is with these vacuum fermentation lids. I used to ferment in like 20 years ago, and I'd always get mold in the top, and it always bugged me. And nowadays with the vacuum fermentation lids, and I like to use either, you know, quart-sized mason jars or half-gallon mason jars, and I put the vacuum fermentation lid on, and I suck all the extra oxygen out, and when you do that, the mold can't grow in there. So that's really nice. So then if you guys want to be cooking your food, and I recently started cooking my food, my stove has been disconnected for like the last 20 years, and I've owned an Instant Pot because I started making you know, fresh food for my dog in the Instant Pot, but now this is the only way I choose to cook these days. And the best cooking methods, if you guys want to heat process your food, are through pressure cooking, steaming, and boiling. These are cooking it in water, and you're going to keep the temperature lower so you don't create carcinogens in the food while you're cooking it, actually. And so the worst ways to cook your food are for frying, which is the worst of them all, baking above 212 degrees, and I'm not a big fan of microwaving or nuking your food, as they call it, myself. But so, like, I only will cook things in the Instant Pot. So I just put potatoes in the Instant Pot, eggplant in the Instant Pot, all my greens in the Instant Pot, mushrooms in the Instant Pot. I mean, it's really saved me, because I'm just, you know, I'm a guy. I mean, I don't like to really get hardcore to cook it, and I don't know how to, like, do all these things, but, like, I just put it in there, put it in for, like, 0 minutes or 1 minute, and it cooks, and it's, like, good. I like it. I tend to eat a lot of things plain. I don't, like, overly spice them or flavor them or anything, but, you know, that's my personal preference. But it'd probably be good to use some kind of spices, because these could also be good for your microbiome. So here's my summary today. My summary is to grow a wide variety of colorful and deep colored crops, grow using trace minerals and microbes, eat a minimally processed your food to maintain and maximize your nutrition out of the food you're eating, and then I want you guys also to be grateful every day for waking up. And then if you guys want to learn more about me and see more in detail you know, videos about any of these topics, because a lot of these topics I discuss in depth in individual videos, because this is just mostly an overview, you can watch me on YouTube. I have over 3,100 videos these days, and I've been viewed over 184 million times throughout all my videos at growingyourgreens.com, which will take you to my Growing Your Greens YouTube channel, where I teach gardening. I have a OK Raw channel, where I teach about the healthy plant-based eating, the diet style that I'm on, including putting up my personal microbiome test, where I share that with the world and share how to do it yourself, and then how to diagnose it and upload the data to a different site to kind of see and kind of get an idea of where you are on your health journey from your microbiome test. And of course, I have a YouTube channel, youtube.com/rawfoods, which will take you to my discountjuicers.com YouTube channel, where I demonstrate the equipment, including the vacuum blender. Then I do head-to-head comparisons between vacuum blending and traditional blending, so you guys can see the difference on the screen. And I wish people were there to taste the difference, because that's really what's going to get you. Once you start tasting the difference in the vacuum blending, you're just going to be sold. So yeah, I'm glad. I think I have another maybe 15 minutes. I could take a few questions if you guys have any questions. Yes?
Any rock quarry dust?
Any rock quarry dust.
So any local quarry?
Yeah, so the question is, can I use any rock quarry dust? So there's certain kinds of rocks that are better than others for using rock dust. You know, so generally you want to try to find a rock quarry that has like some kind of volcanic or basalt rocks. You know, the other kind of rocks, you know, may have too high, you know, limestone, or have two different kinds, you know, different kinds of minerals. So the goal with the rock dust is we want a nice wide spread of minerals. There's a company called Azomite that makes, you know, a product that you guys could buy through like a farm supply store in many cases. You can look at azomite.com. There's a guy, rockdustlocal.com, where he will source and go through different quarries and maybe be able to supply you or recommend a quarry near you, or he'll ship you some product. Okay, yeah, so the question is about pickling or fermentation. So pickling to me is different than fermentation. So pickling in an acid environment generally will stop bacterial growth. That's why, you know, that's a preservation method. So pickling something in vinegar is not the same as lactic acid fermentation using microbes to basically create the lactic acid that will then preserve your food, that will then they'll also reproduce. So that's, it's not the same. So, I mean, hey, both are good, right? There's some vinegar pickles and vinegar things are, could be good, but I lean towards the side of, the fermentation side to really increase the bacteria in there. Yes?
Yeah, I do refrigerated pickles, so I don't do the processing that heats it up and kills nutrients, but then you eat them within a couple of weeks. So I'm wondering if the vacuum might help keep rules down.
Yeah, so I, when I store things in my refrigerator, I use the vacuum lids, actually. I found that when I store my juices under vacuum in my fridge, kept at the proper temperature, I can store my juices like 7 days, where normally they might go bad in a day or two. And I have videos on this as well, how to store your juices for up to 7 days. It's on YouTube.
What did you say you had a degree in?
I have a degree in marketing. Business
okay.
Management marketing. So this is, I had to learn all this on my own, yes.
Do you have an opinion about Jadon?
Do I have an opinion about Jadon, so Japanese, like natural? Yeah, I think all methods that improve soil are great. You know, I'm kind of like the guy that'll just like, yeah, I'll use techniques from this, techniques from that, and I don't really get into any kind of one system. I try to like pick the best out of different systems and incorporate that into what I do. I mean, that's the same with my diet. I don't necessarily believe in one diet. I just do all the things that make sense to me and, yeah. Yes?
A question on vacuum fermenting.
Vacuum fermenting.
Yes. We do quite a bit. We have weeds and, plastic bags with water in them just to keep everything low and water level. Under vacuum, are you worrying about or making all that juice and having it all over?
So here's the thing. So like my vacuum pump, my normal vacuum pump, electric vacuum pump runs, will pull about 20 inches of mercury. And then if I'm super crazy, I have a hand pump that I can get up to maybe 22 inches of mercury. So when I ferment, some lids will limit the amount you can vacuum. So they might limit you because like some of the lids on Amazon with the stupid small pumps, they maybe only pull 10 inches of mercury. So I think at the smaller, limit, at the smaller vacuum, I don't think it's an issue. On some levels it could be good because when I'm vacuuming so strong, especially my juices will be solid, but then if I vacuum them up to like at least 18 inches of mercury, air bubbles will come out of the juice and to come out, that's because like I'm pulling the air out of the liquid. So I think, that could be good because, we don't want the oxygen in there. So that's what you're doing when you're pulling a stronger vacuum. So I haven't seen studies yet, as to super strong vacuum. So maybe just like lean off on it a little bit. But experiment, I say experiment because I don't know the true answer. But like when I vacuum ferment, sometimes I'll pull like 20 inches of mercury on it and it ferments fine. So I don't know the small differences. All right, any other questions today?
So if you're talking about vacuuming, I know that you can buy like vacuum chambers, like you could put glass things in, and then recently I saw something like you can use a food saver to put a jar in to pull it out. So when you're doing, say someone doesn't have the vacuum seal things or whatever, if they had something like that, would that do the same thing? I know that sounds kind of silly, but...
Yeah, no, that's perfect. All right, so the question is regarding, hey, if I have a food saver or a vacuum chamber to vacuum seal things, is that the same thing as what I'm talking about? So, some of those have adapters, so how I normally vacuum seal things myself is with a vacuum pump and these special vacuum lids, which you could buy on Amazon.
Yep.
Some are as cheap as $10, the good ones maybe $20. And you get a nice pump, and I would encourage everybody to get the pump that's like large and has a fat diameter, not a small pump, and not an electric. The cheap electric pumps on Amazon maybe pull like maybe up to 14 inches of mercury, but the manual pump pulls 12. Okay. I'm sorry, 20 to 22. And then they have special lids. So the lids I recommend are stainless steel lids that are reusable, that have like a little plastic insert that has a little valve that goes up and down. A lot of the fermentation lids are just 100% plastic with like the screws on it. I don't like those because I'll vacuum it in and I can never get it undone because I cram them down too hard. So I just like the flat lids. And then they also, you're able to pull more vacuum than the other design of the plastic lids.
Right, okay.
And then, yeah, so then you can have an adapter that to use your food saver on, you know, one of these lids or something. But, I mean, the kits are like $10 to $20, so I just say get a kit.
Okay.
Because it's just easier to have than these vacuum chambers and all these other complicated things.
Right, okay.
All right, well, I think that's it for today. Oh, one more question.
Do you incorporate moringa in
your daily? Do I incorporate moringa into my daily life? So I actually just added old moringa powder that I didn't eat into my dog's food for him to eat. I looked at my moringa tree in my backyard. It's, you know, it dies out every year, but it comes back every spring. So I will eat moringa during the season fresh. I'll just harvest the leaves and eat them in salads. Moringa is a really cool plant because it actually has the isothiocyanates, which are similar to the brassica family plants that are anti-disease and anti-aging. That's why it also has a strong burning flavor when you eat them. I maybe rarely eat some moringa powder, but probably not enough. But I think that's quite a healthy food, yeah. All right, so I'm going to hang out a little bit, maybe outside the tent, because I think the next speaker has to come in to answer any questions if you guys want to come up to me or whatever. And thank you. So wow, I'm so amazed you guys stayed to the end, because you're like a small percentage of people that like stay to the end to learn all the information that I'm sharing. And that really, you know, I feel blessed when you guys stay to the end to watch and learn from all the information that I'm sharing with you guys, right? I now want to ask you guys a question. What did you like most about that presentation? Post it down below. I'm sure to review the comments on a regular basis to kind of see what people really like or dislike. Also, you know, many of the topics I discuss in my presentation, I also cover in detailed videos. You know, I have videos on vacuum blending, on slow juicing, linked down below, videos on using rock dust and worm castings, all the things I talk about, choosing the best kinds of plants to grow and seeds, growing purple plants, links down below to all those videos. So you guys, even though you guys weren't here to hear me live, you guys are in a better position because you guys have the YouTube at your fingertips. You guys could watch all my past episodes so that you guys can improve your health through gardening. And that's, you know, the reason why I got into gardening is to grow higher quality food than money can buy. So if you guys enjoyed this episode, want more videos where I record myself at different lectures I give around the country, give this video a big thumbs up. Also, be sure to share this with other people that you think it could help so that they could bring their level of health up to the next level. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes. I've coming out every 5 to 7 days. You don't know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure to click the little bell so you get notified as my videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 600 episodes at this time on this channel dedicated to teach you guys all about how to grow organic fruits and vegetables at home of the highest quality and use them the best ways possible. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.